these fish,
we will catch and release.
We are back again fighting for freedom, liberty, crocodiles and a big fat Cuban cigar. In the latest Ubisoft Montreal, Shanghai Atel, destroy 'em up, we're in Cuba in all but name. Here it's called Yara, which has a distinct tropical feel of the first and third entries. But the real battle though is between platforms. So let's break down those barricades. This is Far Cry. You all know the score by now. Choose your protagonist from male or female now. Run from certain death while all around die. Get angry, then get even. Powered again by the Junior 2 engine that was introduced in Far Cry 3, and this setting feels very familiar. From lush sandy beaches, translucent blue sea, swaying palm trees, and lots of dynamite death and destruction, within minutes you feel at home and all the standard tropes play out as expected. Visually, it is a good game with great use of dense foliage that sways in the wind, dynamic wind and weather, volumetric clouds, virtualized texture systems to create a wealth of assets as you travel. They stream in and out of RAM consistently, and it's all capped off with a dynamic time of day and good lighting and effects. In this new gen era though, it's starting to look its age, specifically around materials as they rely heavily on albedo maps, causing excessively diffuse properties with skin, wood and even cloth having very similar reactions under many light conditions. Dirt, wood, metals all look detailed enough, worn and rocky, but they lack any true energy consumption, giving the game its signature cartoon look, which admittedly works in its favour, certainly on the comedic gore. But it is starting to date, and even on PC this is true with ray trace reflections and shadows bumped up along with other effects. It remains equally true, and at times can resemble Far Cry 3 a little too much. Complete with some screen tearing, albeit nowhere near as horrendous as that slasher fest level back in the day on Xbox 360 and PS3, which actually sums up the melee kills here, which do resemble a certain sociopathic Jason Voorhees vibe.
Not the only one looking for glass. What's this?
So let's cover resolution. Series X and PS5 first. 3840 by 2160 in gameplay at 60fps is the target, and at cinematics it runs at 30 across all of them including PC. Now some of these are movie files, but most of them are real-time ones, and it does stand out. This might be a limit of the motion capture solution or just an issue to get the game out of the door, I don't know, but they are capped at 30 across every platform no matter the power you've got under the hood. They run at 4K natively almost all the time on PS5 and Series X. I didn't count any point below that, but in gameplay it definitely does drop below this, and obviously this means that you get an adaptive solution. The IQ is very good, especially in these cinematics, it's pin sharp, but in gameplay you can see obvious signs of reconstruction in effect, likely from an updated version of HRAA hybrid reconstruction anti-aliasing, if the base resolution drops below that. And from my counts it does. It often sits somewhere around 3200 by 1800 on the PS5 and equivalent 3360 by 1890 on the Series X. So there's somewhere between 5 and 10% delta between the two. But at its lowest point it can drop as low as 3072 by 1728 on the PS5 and 3168 by 1782 on the Series X. So they are close, but generally because they're so close and that reconstruction, they tend to look absolutely identical. You can see some blurring and reconstruction elements specifically on signs in lateral movement. As you can see here, as I move left and right, it slightly blurs. But on these premium consoles, due to that 4K-like action and such high base pixel counts at 60fps, it is a sharp and stable IQ. The Series S is not the same though. This still does target that 30-60 split, but it's now scaling between 2560 by 1440 right down to 1920 by 1080 with the same TAA HRAA recon to fill in the gaps back to that 1440p ceiling. And although it is stable in motion, it does look soft and obviously sub 4K. Even in static edge sections, let alone movement, with texture blur and the movement significantly worse in the Series X and the PS5, and even the Pro and the Xbox One X. It's generally somewhere sub 1440p in action, and often it can be 1080p, but it is running at twice the frame rate of the Xbox One X and the PS4. Now, sorry, the PS4 Pro. The Xbox One X does again target a 4K resolve, but it can dynamically scale right down to 1620p, but it looks sharper and resolves far more detail and action than its smaller brother. Due to the lack of that Zen CPU though, this does now target 30fps in gameplay, and like all previous entries in the series on consoles up until now, aside the boost modes. The Pro is the same as the S with a 2560 by 1440p target, but unlike the others, I couldn't really find any counts below it. It would be mad if it didn't have it, but often the same points I was counting that dropped below that on the Pro, they just sat at 1440p, certainly during the opening couple of hours. It too lacks that 60fps update, and although it's still a pretty game, it can look softer in comparison to the Xbox One X and certainly the PS5 and Series X. PS4 comes in with an almost static 1920 by 1080, which actually looks quite good considering, but you definitely need a 1080p screen as it can look soft and lacking clarity on a 4K one. Again, in motion, the breakdown resolve is apparent at times, but the AA here is less intrusive and it has been dialed back in cost. So I believe that helps out some of the image, certainly in terms of the performance and the cleanness of the image. Can look slightly sharper, but I did count a low of 1728 by 972, which is still a decent output considering the age of this machine. And by far the worst offender of IQ crimes is that aging Xbox One, which manages to highlight both the quality of the temporal result when stationary and the intense muddiness when in transit. As you can see from my examples here, the 1600 by 900p high point is borderline too low. With such an aggressive reconstructed AA pass, with any medium fidelity details being smudged within an inch of their lives, textures, thin edges, or even signs take on the effect of beer goggles as you try to read the chip shop menu after a really good night out. Helping this is a counted low of 1440 by 810, which could go even lower, but is often in action sub 900p, so the game still looks good, but many of the details are lost within that TAA. Other sacrifices in the stack do come. The Xbox One S does have cutbacks on SSR, it's much closer in that far clip plane than other versions. LOD is also lower, as are the shadow maps and other post effects such as screen space ambient occlusion. They're all tied to resolution buffers, so they are lower when you start scaling down that output target. The rest are closer on LOD, SSR. LOD is higher on the Xbox One X, even over the Pro and the PS4, but just as with the Series S, which is somewhere in between the Series X and the PS4 Pro, it's actually worse, certainly on the foliage, than the Xbox One X, but the Series X and the PS5 have the highest settings of them all, and they look close to the absolute best on PC. As you can see here, these actual machines really reduce the amount of popping. Certainly when it comes to terrain detail, the tessellation, that looks like it's ultra here, but certainly you can see examples on screen. Look at the distance in the background with the foliage. The foliage is on ultra as well. You can see where those billboards are not swapped out. They're actually animated geometry swaying around in the breeze, where on high they're not. It doesn't have any of the ray trace reflections or the ray trace shadows that the PC has, but again, they're quite subtle, but I'll get to that in a moment. Overall, the settings between the best on PC and on console, you can see here. They certainly cut back on the geometry and environmental LOD, so that's on high, not ultra. And they look like they've got shadows on high. They've got water on ultra, but you can see the rest of the settings on the screen. Effectively, it's pretty close to the best you can get on PC, and that's borne out in terms of the overall image quality being very, very close, but it does use that temporal reconstructed element and that dynamic scaling which is available in the PC menu. You've also got other options in there, including the FSR option, which I haven't tested here, but it is available. It's not in use on the consoles because that adds an additional element of sharpening, which I actually prefer at certain points. I think it's quite a good technique when it's the right level of texture details, and it works here in terms of just improving that image quality. So moving into performance, what have we got? Well, it's not quite as identical with all three now-gen machines offering 60fps, and they do a great job in those tested first few hours. Being an open-world dynamic game, though, I am sure there's some heavier points do exist, and the results are good for that, but overall, I'm not saying that this is exactly as you'll get all the way through the game, but it performs very well. All three can tear adaptively on the full height of the screen. It's not that often, and it's certainly nothing like Far Cry 3 that closed out the 360 PS3 era, but if the screen is filled with foliage, then the title can be bandwidth, fill rate bound at times, and this causes tearing, albeit briefly, when it's traversing the world. PS5 does tend to tear a little more than the Series X. In fact, it was 0.3% of my tested footage tore on the Series X, whereas 0.54% tore on the PS5. It's incredibly small amount of tearing that's going on. Ultimately though, with some tearing and dynamic scaling, all three deliver a smooth and enjoyable entry on consoles. That is by far the smoothest we have seen so far. There are a couple of dropped frames here and there, but never any more than 33 milliseconds, aside some general streaming stutter points that can happen on every single machine. The Xbox One X offers great performance at 30fps, with again only mild and infrequent tears cropping up from time to time. Compared here to the others, you can see the IQ benefit, but also the consistent 30 to 60 is an obvious boost between the Series S and the Xbox One X. It is a great shame that dual modes of 30 to 60 were not offered on the Series S, but I suspect that smaller RAM allocation in the S and the weaker GPU means that a native 4K at 30 was actually not an option. This is reinforced by the texture tester in terms of comparing the HD textures on the old consoles and the new consoles. You can't run them on the old consoles, but you can install them on the Series S, Series X, the Series S, and the PS5, but you can't install them on anything else. I did try, you can't. And you can see that the Series S doesn't load them all, so you're still getting lower quality textures here, even though it's installed, whereas on the PS5 and the Series X, due to the additional RAM available, it can fit those into that slot. And that actually is true of PC as well, but this is generally a bug. Even on my RTX 2070 here, and the HD pack applied, I could not get the quality of textures to work. It likely needs far more RAM allocated to it. I've only got 8 GB here, so potentially this is a game that's looking for somewhere around 10 to 12 gigabytes of RAM. It does say that this bumps up around 1.2 gigabytes in terms of installing the VRAM, but obviously a game like this is going to dynamically allocate that into a virtualized texture pool. That means that you can't say how much it's going to use, and in fact I maxed out my 8 gig here, even though it's telling me in the menu I'm only going to use 6.6. so I definitely see it being VRAM bound here, and that means that the premium consoles not only give you a better benefit in terms of the ultra settings almost across the board, not all of them as I mentioned, but in terms of the texture details, they're better than what I can get on this PC. If you've got a more powerful and a bigger VRAM, then it won't be a problem on PC. I'm sure they will load in just as well and just as sharp. In terms of performance, the RX 5600 is somewhere between the 50s and 60s, again with the same settings and dynamic scaling at 4K. It has the same issues with lower texture RAM, but that has 6 GB, whereas the RTX 2070 here has 8 GB. That tends to hover a little bit better into the 50s. It can dip down to the 40s, but it does scale more aggressively. Not as aggressively as the AMD cards does, so it tends to hover somewhere between 1440, 1620, whereas obviously the AMD card is somewhere around that 1440p metric more often. And that keeps performance the same or slightly higher, but again, like I say, it is a lower resolution than both the RTX 2070, and then that itself is low on the PS5 and the Series X. The PC version is very good. It's a little bit too aggressive in terms of VRAM usage between the consoles. At some points, there's lower textures here than there is on the Xbox One X, and that just doesn't make sense at all. There's 8 GB of dedicated VRAM here, but overall, it's still a well-performing, well-operating title on the PC, and it scales appropriately with hardware. The DXXR options don't add a great deal to the visual quality of the title. They certainly improve shadows, as you can see here, with that soft penumbra edge, that feathered edge, and some contact hardening improvements. And the reflections are just a refined version of the screen space reflections. You don't got that occlusion error anymore, but it is still using an SSR fallback, so most of the time you wouldn't notice the difference. It can have around a 15-20% impact, so for me, it's not worth turning them on, and it obviously can cause dynamic scaling to be more aggressive. In terms of the PC versus console, you can see here Ultra Shadows versus PS5, which is the same as the Series X. They're on high, they're flicking over there, and then this is Ultra settings compared to PS5. You can see that they look the same as Ultra. There's so many elements that are the same. It's just really that sacrifice that they've made in terms of the LOD by keeping it a little lower back. Shadows are on high, and volumetrics are on high. Everything else appears to be generally ultra, and playing them side by side, you wouldn't notice the difference. Again, here on the PS4 Pro, there's not a lot to discuss. It's a perfect performing, perfectly optimized title, 1440p. Again, it might scale, I just didn't catch any points where it did. One single drop, no tearing. It's perfectly optimized, and it runs as per the best Far Cry game on consoles that's ever ran. It's slightly better than the Xbox One X, but then it has got lower quality settings. And finally, you've got the PS4 and the Xbox One S. And again, they run impeccably considering all the nips and tucks we've just mentioned. They are the right thing to do to get performance at the level they've got. They've optimized it correctly. By making all of these sacrifices, you get pretty much a locked 30 FPS. Sure, it can tear, obviously, like all versions, and it tears more often here than the Xbox One S. If it's going to be a streaming stutter, a RAM issue, some kind of checkpoint judder, that will happen more often than not on the Xbox One S, but it can happen on every single format. It's just more prone on the S. But overall, if you have played or are looking to play a Far Cry title, it's the best performing one right across the stack, and I have to commend the team for doing that. And also, loading significantly improves across all versions. It's very, very quick, circa anywhere between 30 seconds on the lower end consoles up to about 7 or 8 seconds on the PS5 and the Series X. And it looks as good as any Far Cry game has looked. It plays as good as any Far Cry game has played. But it doesn't really change the game in any way, shape, or form. It's the best looking Far Cry. Take that as you will. Anyway, that's it for a deep dive into the consoles and PC versions across the board. Hopefully you enjoyed this technical insight and performance metric view of the titles across every format you could possibly pick up, and you can fill in the gaps between that are left over. There isn't that many. Hopefully if you did enjoy this or anything else game and technology related, then keep it IGN Games by hitting that subscribe button down below, and we will see you on the next one.